A warm welcome to the 39th lecture on the subject of advanced digital signal processing, specifically multirate processing and wavelets. In the previous couple of lectures, we have looked at some very interesting expositions by students who looked at applications of wavelets and multirate digital signal processing. One of the successes and one of the joys in conveying a subject is to see how well it is reflected in the understanding of the student, and more so if the student could actually challenge the teacher by giving an alternate proof or by rectifying an inaccurate statement and by providing a more accurate statement with a more accurate exposition. So, among the audience of the course has been, other than the students who presented some excellent application presentations in the previous couple of lectures, one student who pointed out an inaccuracy in the way in which we dealt with a very fundamental principle, but you know, perhaps not as accurately as it should have been. So, he pointed out that although it was correct that a function cannot be compactly supported both in time and frequency, he also pointed out that the reasons for this had not been accurately explained. And I was very happy to see that there was this alternate proof which he brought out, which I shall now ask him to present in this lecture, the 39th. So, I present to you Soham Bosu, one of the students, one of the audience of the course, who then looked carefully at this issue of trying to be compactly supported in both domains, time and frequency, and came out with a much better explanation of the inability to have compactness in both the domains. I have asked Soham to present himself, both the theme which he is going to talk about, the concepts that underlie the proof and the proof itself. So, here we have Soham Bosu to follow.
Hello everyone. Today we will be looking at a particular proof of a theorem based on the uncertainty principle in Fourier transform. So, here is what we are going to look at. Proof that a non-zero function cannot be both time and band limited at the same time. Basically, by this we mean that a function cannot have a compact support both in its time domain and its Fourier domain. So, this is already a well known theorem, and some proofs of this exist. We will have an overview of the existing proofs and also the new proof that I have furnished up. So, here is what we mean by time limitedness and band limitedness or compactness in general. So, suppose we have a function f which we draw like this. By the support of the function, we mean the interval outside which the function is 0. For example, if I take a rectangular pulse like this, the support of the function is this. Say it's a to b, then the support is just the interval a to b. On the other hand, if I take the Gaussian function, the support is a whole real line. So, function is said to be limited or said to have a compact support when this support is finite in length. For example, for the rectangular pulse. So let us first look into the general background on which we will be working. So we will be considering Fourier transform, which is one way of looking into a signal from its frequency domain. By frequency, we mean sine waves. Sine waves define frequency. So over here, we will be considering translates of sine waves and their linear combinations. So if we do it in the complex domain, we can bring out exponentials, because we can split up sine functions like this. Sine omega can be written as e to the power I omega minus e to the power minus I omega by 2. So if I want to write the complex exponential e to the power I theta, I can write it as I sine theta plus cos theta. But again, cos theta is a translate of sine theta, which is pi by 2 minus theta. So basically, like all other transforms, the general idea of Fourier transform is to project a function onto the space of e to the power I omega t or e to the power minus I omega t. The mathematical formula is given like this. For a function f, the Fourier transform, if it exists, is given by f of s equal to f t into e to the power minus 2 pi I s t integrated over dt, over the whole of the real line. The function f is taken over the whole of the real line, the domain of the function. For the inversion of this formula, we need some conditions on fs. So if the inversion holds, for generally when a function f belongs to L1 or L2 R, then the inversion formula holds, and it's just given by a similar formula. There is just a change in the sign in the dependent variable of the exponential part. So now we have come across L1 and L2, or in general we also consider the spaces LP for functions. So let us define that spaces first. By a space LP, if we say that a function belongs to LPR, what we mean by that is the pth power of the modulus of the function, when integrated over the whole real line, say this is t, is finite. For example, the function which we took, rectangular function, say it goes from minus a by 2 to a by 2. This belongs to LP, basically all LPs for p real numbers. On the other hand, the function sinc x, by sinc x we mean sine pi x by pi x. So if we draw, it goes at x equal to 0, the limit goes to 1. So it goes something like this. But this function doesn't belong to L1, because if we take the modulus of this, the areas become positive. Here the areas cancel out a bit and the final integral becomes pi by 2. On the other hand, here this parts become positive, and if we fit in triangles into this, we can see that the area of the triangles diverge. So the area of modulus sinc x is also going to diverge. So in this new proof, we will be first considering functions which belong to classes L1, and hence we will be extending the class of functions to general LP p from 1 to infinity. So there's a very general inequality which states that when a function belongs to LP, p between 0 to p between 1 to infinity, it also belongs to L1. So mathematically, f belonging to Lp, p belonging to 1 to infinity implies that f belonging to L1. So for the time limited function, this can very easily be proved with Holder's inequality. Holder's inequality states that for two functions f and g, this integral is less than equal to So, here are the conditions for Holder's inequality to hold. The main point is 1 by p plus 1 by q has to be equal to 1, and of course p and q both positive. From this we can get the range of p and q. So if we take p to be less than 1, then q becomes negative. So p can only go from p and q both can only go from 1 to infinity. Equal to infinity is also allowed if I allow 1 on one side. So, here is the proof of this theorem. There is another inequality called Young's inequality, which states the following fact. Given any two real numbers, positive real numbers, A and B, AB is less than A to the power P by P plus b to the power q by q. This thing is very easy to prove if we use the generalized AMGM inequality. Of course, the same conditions hold over here, 1 by p plus 1 by q equal to 1, or otherwise p by q is equal to pq. So, for the proof of this, we will be using the generalized AMGM inequality. Here is the generalized inequality. Given two numbers A, B, and alpha 1 and alpha 2 are the weights of A and B, we have this result. A and B are positive real numbers. So, over here let us try to fit in the numbers which we have been given. Let us take alpha 1 to be q and a to be a to the power p, alpha 2 to be p and b to the power q. Below, if we write p1 p plus q, we can as well write pq instead of this, since we already know that 1 by p plus 1 by q is equal to 1. Similarly, on the other side, we get pq and the pqth root of a to the power p whole to the power q and b to the power q whole to the power p. Taking real values for p and q, and as they are not 0, we can cancel this, and what we get is a to the power p by p plus b to the power q by q on the left hand side. On the right hand side, we get the pqth root of ab to the power pq. This is greater than equal to. So, finally, we have got the Young's inequality. Now, say there are two functions f and g such that f belongs to Lp and g belongs to Lq. With the same conditions, 1 by p plus 1 by q equal to 1. So, from Young's inequality, let us redefine f as f is equal to f by the pth norm of f. The pth norm is this over the whole of dt. G is also redefined the same way, G by qth norm of G. Now, let us put in this f and g point wise as numbers ft and gt in the Young's inequality. So, ft to the power p by p, gt to the power q by q is greater than equal to ft gt. Ft and gt can be complex valued functions also. So, we take numbers by defining the modulo. So, if we integrate this over the whole of the real line, we basically get out holeless inequality. Because on one hand, we are going to get 1 because it is the weighted pth norm of ft already. We get 1 by p on one side plus 1 by q on the left hand side, which equals 1, and on the right hand side we have got mod ft into mod gt, the integral where ft and gt are weighted. Now, if you bring out the weights and multiply with 1, we get that the pth norm of f into the qth norm of g is greater than equal to the integral of the modulus. So, this basically proves holeless inequality. How are we going to use this in our proof? So, say a function f is time limited. Can we show that if it belongs to Lp class, it belongs to L1 class also? Yes, we can by choosing a suitable g. So, say the function that we are interested in is non-zero on this particular interval C only, compactly supported in C and 0 everywhere else. So, we can write down only on C because everywhere else the function is 0. The holeless inequality. Now, we can choose g in such a manner that g is 1 only on the interval C and 0 everywhere else. In that case, on the LHS, only mod f remains. On the RHS, there is the pth norm to the power 1 by p of f, and g has been replaced by 1 on the compact support C. So, it is just 1 into dt to the power 1 by q, which will basically give me out the measure of C to the power 1 by q. So, on the right hand side, it is the norm of Fp, which we already know is finite, and the measure of C is also finite, as f has been assumed to be time limited. On the LHS, as this is less, this has necessary, f should necessarily belong to L1. Next, we will move on to some tools that we will be using for this whole thing. The tools are a particular Fourier transforms, and in linear algebra, the Vandermonde matrix. So, we will be considering the Fourier transform of the rectangular pulse. It is defined as to have a value 1 between a by 2 to minus a by 2 and 0 everywhere else. So, this is a real symmetric function. In Fourier analysis, we know that a real symmetric function gives a real symmetric functions. Otherwise, what we can do is, in the Fourier integral, for a symmetric function ft, we can just take the cos 2 pi omega t part, because the sin omega t will give us a 0. So, let us see what comes out over here. Now, the interval changes from minus a by 2 to a by 2, because all the rest is 0. And the way we define the sinc functions, this is just sinc a of omega. And this structure of the sinc function, the factor a is only inside the sine part, is very crucial for our proof. Next, the Vandermonde matrix. This matrix is defined as Cj's are the different values for different columns, and their corresponding powers in different rows are I minus 1. So, when it is written down, the matrix becomes like this: a1 square up to say n, a1 to the power n. On the other side, if it is a n, then it goes as a n square and stops at a n to the power n. So, whenever we have a linear equation a x equal to y vectors, we are always looking at invertibility of a, so that when we know y, we can solve x like this. Now, Vandermonde matrix have some very nice properties for which it can be shown to be invertible if we just know the entries. So, here it is how it works. So, a1 to the power n, and in between, let us replace any particular column by x. So, it goes as x square till x to the power n. Now, let us take the determinant of the matrix. So, we can take the determinant here already. Let us call it dx. This will be a polynomial in x with the maximum power x to the power n. If we put x equal to a1, these two columns are going to be the same and the determinant will come out to be 0. Similarly, for all other a's except, say we have put this x at the jth column, except aj, for all other a's, this determinant is coming out to be 0. So, the polynomial dx will be of the form some constant, which is minus 1 to the power some power into pi x minus a l's, l goes from 1 to n but not equal to j, and the rest part. This rest part can be found out. Now, let us replace x by a j. So, it is a j minus a l. Similarly, in this matrix, we can replace other columns by x also and do the same operation. So, for each and every column, there will be a product like this. But in the determinant, the highest power of a 1 that we can have is a 1 to the power n. With that limitation, what finally comes out by combining all these products is ai minus aj, say I less than j, so that we do not repeat and I is not equal to j ever. In that case, it is just 0. Now, matrix M is invertible whenever the determinant mod M is not equal to 0. So, over here, whenever my entries in the first row a1 up to an are mutually distinct, we get that the determinant is not equal to 0. So, it is always invertible in that case. Next, we will move on to our theorem that a function cannot be compactly supported both in its time and its Fourier domain. So, the function, only non-zero functions we will be considering, because in our proof we will be showing that the only function which is allowed to have this property is the identically zero function. So, let us first consider some very smooth functions which have compact support. For example, the function e to the power in between minus 1 to 1 and 0 otherwise. So, it can be shown the function has a structure like this, e to the power x falls off. When x goes near 1, this part goes near infinity, and because of the minus sign, cx tends towards 0. Not only that, if we take the derivative of cx, what we get is the minus parts cancel out. Now, as x goes near 1, this thing goes near infinity as before, and the exponential part falls off. On the other hand, the lower part of this thing goes towards infinity, but exponential falls off faster than any polynomial that can be made. So, overall this thing tends towards 0 if we take the limit, and this holds for all derivatives. Not only c prime x, it holds for all c p x, p belonging to natural number. From this, it can be shown that the function is very smooth. So, at minus 1 and 1, this function and all its derivatives tend towards 0. So, can we have a very well-behaved function like this also, for which the Fourier transform is compactly supported? So, there are various proofs which use various sort of things, for example, analyticity, holonomicity and all those things. So, I will first state one proof and give a brief overview of it. When a function is band limited, and say the function f belongs to L1, then as fs can be written like this, we can have a bound on the modulus of fs. Now, this is 1, but this is the L1 norm of F1. The Fourier transform of the derivative of f dash t, if it exists, is going to be I omega f into e to the power minus 2 pi I omega t dt. Now, we have assumed f to be time limited. So, instead of the whole real line, the only interval we can handle now, we will be handling now, is the compactly supported interval C. Now, over here also, because omega is in C only, t is in C only, when you take the modulus, again we will get a bound for f dash t. We can show that all these derivatives f dash t hold at all points when f is both time limited and band limited. So, over here f was band limited, so for only some interval omega 1 to omega 2 it would have been non-zero f omega, and for the rest it would have been 0. So, if that holds, we can write the function f t by the Maclaurin expansion as f 0 plus t into f t 0 and so on. Now, due to the assumptions on f, all this number exists. So, this is basically a power series expansion. And this holds for all t. In that case, by the identity theorem, if this power series is 0 on any open interval, it is going to be 0 everywhere on the real line. For compactly supported f, of course, the power series is 0 outside the compact support C. In that case, only the 0 function f equal to 0 is allowed, because the function reduces to 0 by the identity theorem. This theorem states that a function f, which is holonomic, which has a power series everywhere, is defined completely by any its values on any open interval. Now, the whole motivation of this proof is, new proof is, that all this previous proofs that are there using holonomicity or celebrated Paley theorem, this require complex analysis and request mastery in complex analysis. You have to know quite some bit of complex analysis to know this basics. On the other hand, we have many other ways of looking into signals. band limited signals, of course, we have come across the Shannon-Nyquist reconstruction formula, or the Shannon-Weitekar or cardinal series, whatever it is called, the reconstruction formula is a way to look into this theorem with that. So, in Shannon's revolutionary paper in signal processing, he gave this formula, which is called the Shannon-Nyquist formula. What is so revolutionary about it? So, this formula holds when FH is band limited. This FHK is the samples. So, say there is a function f like this. Can we have an operation for measuring the function ft, we have to take the value of ft at each and every point. Instead of that, if there is some limitation on f, over here the limitation is in the Fourier domain, it is compactly supported. So, can we remove the redundancy if there is some? So, indeed there is some redundancy. In the Fourier domain, because it is band limited, we can take only the samples at regular intervals. So, h is our sampling time, it goes over all k's, and from that we can get back our ft. We will show graphically how this works. So, say a function ft is compactly supported in its Fourier domain. We will be using distribution theory for this function, for this proof, but in the actual proof I have used just real analysis, no distribution theory, but for the sake of brevity we will be showing here with distribution theory, which equally holds. So, if you take a train of delta functions, by delta functions we mean say a function delta function is defined like this. The integral over the whole real line is 1, but the function is 0 at all points except t equal to 0. So, this is not actually a function in the normal sense, it is a distribution. For a Dirac delta train, on the other hand side, we also get another Dirac delta train, a series of pulses like this. So, if this is t, the difference between this is 1 by t. Now, we know that multiplication in the Fourier domain implies convolution in our real set, the time domain, and vice versa. So, over here we multiply in the time domain with delta functions, and this gives us sampling, it just picks up the values at those particular points and everywhere else it is 0. So, we get some weight delta functions AI plus 2 or something like that. On the other side, capital F is getting convolved with delta function, but there is another property of delta function, that its convolution with any function gives the same function back. So, over here this whole capital F will be repeated along the delta train, at each and every delta it will be repeated and the whole thing will be summed up. Final outcome is something like this. Now, can we reconstruct the signal from this? Say we had the repeated lobes like this. If we did ideal low pass filtering with a rectangular pulse over here, on the other hand side on this side, we would have got our actual FS back. Now, Fourier transform is a one-to-one operation. So, on the other side, the corresponding operation should give us back F only. So, over here, we can already see what is going to happen. The threshold conditions say the repetitions of FS is overlapping like this. We cannot do the ideal low pass filtering. So, the condition for ideal reconstruction is that the capital F lobes have to be well separated, and this is a threshold condition where they exactly touch. Say this is band limited by S, minus S to S. In that case, our repetition rate has to be good enough so that they become well separated. If we make the delta trains closer in the time domain, in the frequency domain, they are going farther apart. So, threshold condition, this is 2s and 1 by t. So, 1 by t should be greater than 2s, greater than equal to 2s. So, t should be less than equal to 1 by 2s. And when this equality is there, that is the Shannon-Nyquist threshold condition. Now, let us consider functions which are time limited and band limited. So, after multiplying with the delta train, we get lobes like this and sampling over here. For FT, which is compactly supported in the time domain, we get only a finite number of samples which are non-zero. Everywhere else it is zero. On the Fourier domain, if we take T to be sufficiently small, or H, which we'll be using over here. On the other side, they are well separated with zeros in between them, whole intervals which are zeros. Now, we have a freedom on the reconstruction. We can multiply this whole repetition with a rectangular function which goes from this point to this point. Because this is just one, it is going to give us Fs till this rectangular function remains within this range. So, we will have some other freedom. Let us call the rectangular function, it goes to sigma prime, and sigma is the band limit. So, we will define a parameter m which is 2h sigma prime. On the other hand, in the time domain, by corresponding operations, we get the series to be the cardinal series or the Shannon-Whittaker series to be FHK sinc of, here the m comes in. And there is a factor of m in the front. Now, F is time limited. So, k will not go from minus infinity to infinity, it will stop somewhere, say at n. So, now this is a finite series. Now, what I told before, the property of sinc function, the sinc becomes sin pi m t minus h k by h. Due to this structure of the sinc function, these two m's are going to cancel out, which is very necessary for our proof. Now, what was the condition on m? We did not find out exactly, but here was sigma. Here was the repetition. So, sigma prime had to be between, this was say 1 by t. So, if we take sigma prime lies between 1 by 2 t to sigma, then this exactly holds. We can derive that with m, whenever m lies between 1 and 2 h sigma, the reconstruction formula holds. If the reconstruction formula holds, the series, cardinal series, converges to f t. Now, k goes from some finite number n minus n to n. Now, when this condition is satisfied, the m for all real m like this, this holds exactly. In that case, we can take this cardinal series to be a function of m and t, and if you fix t, f t becomes a number, t minus h k by h becomes become numbers. So, we have a freedom of m which we can manipulate. Let us take the first derivative of c m t, where t is fixed, so we will not write t anymore. So, c prime m t minus h k by h comes out, it gets cancelled, pi also gets cancelled, and we are left with f h k cos m pi t minus h k by h, k going from minus n to n. Now, f t was already fixed. So, when we take the derivative with respect to m, it is just 0. So, c prime m is 0, and here is this finite series. If we write it graphically, so this is a plot of c m t with respect to m. So, when m lies between 2 h sigma and 1, this is going to give us f t. We do not know what is going on outside, but over here we are sure that this is a constant function. So, we can take as many derivatives as we want of c m t with respect to m. So, let us take second order derivatives of c prime m. Second order derivatives with respect to m for this cos, it will just bring out pi minus t k h by h to the power 2 y. So, say this is the ith second order derivative, 2 I plus 1. And all of them are going to be identically 0, because c m is a constant function when m is like this. We can write this whole thing down as a matrix equation. So, say how many samples did we have? It is minus n, 0 and n. So 2n plus 1. We take 2n plus 1 equations like this, doing the derivatives. So the Vandermonde structure, Vandermonde will come later on. So we get a structure like this. And CK So what we are going to get, that VC is equal to 0, writing down all the 2n plus 1 equations. Now this V has a Vandermonde sort of structure. It's going to be invertible as long as t minus hk square ki square is equal to t minus hk to kj square. This thing doesn't hold, and this thing only holds for a finite number of values of t. I not equal to j. Now we can work on the whole of the real line other than this values of t. Let us call this set of t as B. For all other t, we get that C is equal to V inverse into the 0 vector. So it's absolutely 0. So C is 0, CK is 0 for all k. In that case, either FHK is 0 or the cos part is 0, or both of them. Now the cos part can be 0 only when m pi minus this thing, this whole thing equals odd multiple of pi by 2. So only for some finite countable number of values of m this can hold. But in our proof we have a whole range of m. So this is not going to hold for all m if we take any other m. This will give that for all the other m, FHK is equal to 0. Now it can be showed that for a time limited and a band limited function, the functions are very smooth. So all the derivatives exist, they are bounded on both the sides and all these things. So if these things happen, our cardinal series CM, not this one. Our cardinal series is going to converge exactly, not only point wise, but exactly it's going to converge to FT. So if we have FHK is equal to 0, all these things are equal to 0. So if it converges to FT on the other side, I am left with only FT equal to 0, nothing else. But we are missing the set B, T belonging to B. But we already know that F is continuous. So if only for a finite number of points it is non-zero, and for the rest of it it's 0, that cannot hold. It has to be 0 on the whole of the real line. So voila, here it is. We have finally got that only the function f equal to 0 is allowed to have this property.
We've had here a very interesting exposition of the proof of the inability to have simultaneous compact support in time and frequency by Soham. I must appreciate the effort by this young man to look again at the concept carefully, to identify a number of basic lemmas, inequalities and equalities that underlie the proof, and to present it in such a lucid manner. Notwithstanding the fact that there have been small glossing over of points during the proof, which we can condone. The idea has come out beautifully, and he has been able to put across the ideas in a very accurate and a very beautiful manner. So, even though at places we might have found small inaccuracies in writing, which you know one can condone, I thought I should mention that, because when the audience listens to it, it might be found that there are some places where symbols have been missed and so on, or you know written with a little bit of overloading of the symbol and so on, but that happens. I think we can condone that, but otherwise I think the proof has been brought out beautifully, and I think we should appreciate this young man for the beautiful proof and the beautiful way in which he's explained the idea. And it is satisfying in two ways. It is satisfying because it tells us technically how worthwhile it is to pursue the subject of at least trying to be reasonably compactly, or you know, going towards a reasonable support in one domain when the other is compactly supported. We know that there are wavelets that are compactly supported. Now, we also know from the discussion from Soham that in the time domain, in the other domain they cannot be, in the frequency domain they cannot be compactly supported. But the challenge is how close you can go to constraining them in the other domain. So, the challenge becomes evergreen once again. That is the technical reason. The personal reason is that here is a young man who has looked at the concepts of the course carefully and put in his own thought, his own creativity to augment the ideas of the course. I encourage all students who at some time or the other listen to these lectures to take an example from these students who have enthusiastically participated and participate as enthusiastically. Thank you.